What's up, everybody? Austin Lee back here from FraudFi. Today, I want to talk to you about a day in the life of a fraud data scientist. Now, I've been a data scientist at a few different banking institutions, these being Bank of America, Citibank, UBS. I was responsible for implementing AI across the consumer bank at Bank of America. Within the banking institution and being a fraud data scientist, it's a little different than a fraud investigator. So as a data scientist, you're sitting at a little bit higher level and you're trying to see the gaps within the bank and understand how fraudsters are taking advantage of those weak controls. And your goal is to create risk scores or clustering to stop the fraudsters in their tracks. As a fraud data scientist, you typically have two different types of work. On one hand, 20% of your time is gonna be really doing that data science work where you're creating models, doing thorough analysis to understand how to maximize investigation. You might be doing a little bit of automation as well as training and deploying those different models in the bank. So it's great, but it takes a long time. So let me focus on the 80%, because the 20%, if you're a data scientist or you're interested in the field at all, you know how it works. But on the other 80%, it's important for you to focus on this, because I think that's the part that's a little bit different and is gonna be valuable to understand before you get in a role like this. So first is working with other fraud teams. So these will be investigators, operations, different analysts. They're gonna have insights into how to look at fraud, because fraud's always changing. So you need to work with them so you have that boots on the ground view of how to look at your data and how to adapt to new trends quickly, rather than waiting on months and months of data and months of lost money before you start to adapt these models. The second thing is, not all banks' infrastructure for data is created equally. Some banks have decentralized infrastructure, so you can create very powerful and robust models. A lot of other banks have their data in Excel. So for you to create a good model, you have to either build that infrastructure or find quick and dirty ways to implement models that'll save the bank time and money. And the last piece is model risk management. There's a lot of regulation for AI, data science, machine learning that you're not going to be redlining different individuals. So you're not declining them on transactions because they are who they are. You're not racially profiling somebody based on some of their info and their customer profile. So it's important to work with model risk management so your bank doesn't get fined at the end of the day for a model that you have built. Now let's talk about the fun part. Let's talk about that 20%. There's a few different types of models that you'll be creating. One is a supervised model. So basically in this supervised model, you're typically gonna be creating risk scores. And so in this risk score, it might be from 0 to 100 or 0 to 999. But in this risk score, your goal is to have an output and saying how risky this transaction is, so the bank understands, or the credit card payment processing company can quickly react to that scoring model. So with this, you're typically dealing with transaction data. So you're dealing with application data, you're dealing with device data, you're dealing with credit card payment data or banking data, but you're dealing with huge volumes of data. So these models take a lot of time to build and a lot of time to perfect. The second type of model, and I feel like this is one of the easier ones to create, is more of like a non-supervised model. And in this will be like clustering. This will be Graph A.I. But in this, your goal is to catch large rings of fraud and stop those fraudsters from monetizing those different credit card or debit card or banking accounts. So this will be a lot less data, probably 1/100 of the data for the transaction volume. It's a lot easier to implement because you don't need to have it process within seconds. It can be days, and it's a little bit easier to implement with other teams. The last type of work that you'll be doing is creating different quick and dirty analyses. So within fraud, you'll have possibly a fraud attack, or you'll have some sort of circumstance like PPP loans that you need to deal with. And in this, you don't have that historical data that you can look back on to say, hey, this is fraud, but you need to look at the data point in time to understand what's going on and be able to work with your data analyst and fraud investigators to shut down those accounts quickly. So best of luck in your data science ventures. Feel free to ask any questions about what I've done as a data scientist in fraud. Always happy to answer, and see you next time.